And Ewan is on the line in Portugal, originally from Kildare. Ewan, you're welcome to Lunchtime Live on News Talk. How are you?
I'm very well, Claire. Thanks for having me on.
And what's life in Portugal like, as we're talking about comparing to other parts of the world and where they're at with lockdown?
Much better. We locked down last April for about 6 weeks. We were open mid-May, open all summer. Come October, there were some restrictions at weekends based on county numbers, but completely open during the week. And we have a roadmap out of this from the 5th of April. People are allowed to return to dining outdoors on terraces, etc. From the 19th indoors, and from the start of May, everything will be open, because the attitude in Portugal has become that there is a risk, absolutely, but that a healthy society isn't just the absence of illness. And it's quite depressing looking at Ireland, because I guess there's parallels there with the mass psychosis of the Celtic Tiger years. And I don't think people will realise the stupidity of what's been done until the economic reckoning comes. And Ireland is going to be in cinders after this.
Yeah, and I mean, we keep saying there's light at the end of the tunnel, but the tunnel just seems to be getting longer and longer. So you do feel sad looking back at us, do you, from Portugal?
I feel angry. I think there's been a complete dereliction of duty from the government. I think the media have been pathetic. I think they've been an echo chamber for much of this, even if they're beginning to turn with public opinion. I mean, you say, for example, in your intro there, you say you're feeling it the same as everyone else, but you're working, Claire. People, you don't have to be on the PUP. You're in studio interacting with people. You're allowed travel 5k from your house. You don't feel it the same way other people feel it.
I agree with you, Ewan, and I never take that for granted. And I do really think of people who literally have been a year at home seeing no family. I'm also very lucky that a lot of my close family live within my 5 kilometer, and I've been able to see them. So yeah, I think you're very right. We're not all in this together. We're, you know, all experiencing different levels.
Were, though, but there's 25% of people out of work. There's about 3,000 cancers have been missed due to screening. The Oxfam have said the billionaires of Ireland have gained 3.4 billion into their bank accounts during this. Politicians have given themselves 3 pay rises. Public servants have got pay rises for the next 3 years. And when you say we need lockdowns, I mean, and this is what the media have continually missed. Ireland has had about 180 workplace day closures so far. Yet the likes of Iceland, Norway, Finland, Cyprus, Greece, Malta have had none, according to Oxford, and they all have a far lower death toll than Ireland. And we look at protesters and we say, look, they're protesting anti-lockdown. Well, how about looking at it this way? Because they're protesting exactly what the WHO have suggested. Because I want to read you something from October 2020 that the World Health Organization said. They said, we want to say again that we in the WHO do not advocate lockdowns as the primary means of control of the virus. By and large, do not do it. Look what's happening to poverty levels. Look at child malnutrition. This is a terrible, ghastly global catastrophe, actually. And so we really do appeal to all world leaders, stop using lockdown as your primary control method. Yet we in Ireland have NPHET, where lockdown is their primary control method. It's been their go-to, and all that they have said for a year is level 5. That isn't good enough, but they've never been pressured by the media, who have just reported what they tell you. The government have never pressured them. They lay down. We know that from Shane Ross's book. We know that from insights into the cabinet going back to last May, where they felt Tony Houlihan had too much control. And we have an opposition then who actually want this zero COVID crowd, the likes of Anthony Staines, Aoife McGlinsight, Gabriel Scally, Jerry Killeen, Sam McConkie, Thomas Ryan. They, on shows like News Talk, but across Irish media, have been given a platform, and not once have they been asked about leaked emails, which I'm looking at and have been proven. I'm a journalist myself. They were looking for ways to increase insecurity, anxiety and uncertainty. They were willing to lie to the Taoiseach over the danger of the B117 variant. They wanted to put those who stood up to them decisively to the sword. They wanted to humiliate and ridicule. And Jerry Killeen in one said, frankly, I prefer to sort this out with a good hurley and no witnesses.
Yeah, now, but Ewan, are we not asking the question today? I don't really accept that all media are just being drip-fed by the government and all working against the people.
It's a year, Claire.
But are we not asking the question today? You're on. You're the first person we're having on who's questioning it. So Are we not doing that?
The damage has been done. The damage has been done for a year. And to do it now, and to talk about mental health now, and to talk about all these things after lives have been ruined, it's a bit like Georgie Burgess and the Snapper saying, are you all right, Sharon? it's too late. The damage has been done, and for a year, no one questioned it. I, as an award-winning journalist myself, have been driven out of media for trying to raise this for a year. And the damage, I'm not, and it's not about me, but the damage done to poor people, people out looking for the same rights as TDs, as academics, to earn beyond the PUP, they've been demeaned. They've been called the far right.
All they've right, well, Ewan, you're getting a lot of support, a lot of people saying, good man, Ewan, saying it as it is. There is another text, though, that says, it's our national holiday. Can you give it a break? Your constant virus vaccine rules rants are driving us mental. Talk about something good just for today, please. The media are half our problem. But we're talking about planned anti-lockdown protests in Ireland today on St. Patrick's Day and asking for your thoughts on it. And Taoiseach Micheál Martin is in all of the papers today saying we're at a crucial point in the fight against COVID, and that's why we need to not come together. But from even the first few minutes, and even from discussions with my own circle of friends, colleagues, I think we're at a real tipping point in keeping the public on board. I think people are really fed up. And we had Ewan on from Portugal, who is anti-lockdown and thinks Ireland has gone the wrong way about it, and he's getting a great deal of support. I agree 100% with Ewan, said Stephen in Dublin. Great to have someone like that on. I totally agree with Ewan in Portugal. Thanks for putting his opinion out there. He's totally right. The government and media must think the ordinary people are idiots. I don't agree with the media point, says another. We're reporting the story and not being told what to report. Out on streets every day, bringing the stories of people onto the airwaves. You can't blame the bloody media. They are just doing a job. At last, some common sense about lockdown, says another. Your guest is spot on. The media have promoted the zero COVID zealots, and it's time to fight back. Don't dismiss Florida so casually. They never locked down and apocalypse never came. That's from Dermot. And one more from Darren in Swords. Good man, Ewan. Well done, News Talk, for giving a voice to the silent majority. So I'll go back to you, Ewan. What would you like to see happen from here?
A roadmap, hope, a carrot rather than a stick. NPHET not constantly belittling people's efforts because their own mathematical models are wrong. A government with a spine to take back some control, because this isn't solely a health problem, it's also a societal and an economic problem. And rights, basic rights, because this has been framed as a right versus left debate. It's not that. It's actually authoritarianism versus libertarianism. And many people, they don't like it, so they say they're on the left, but they're actually authoritarian. Our Taoiseach, you mentioned there, talking about protests, in 2015, I will quote him, he said, people who restrict the freedom of movement of others are fascists. I think that's hugely telling because, as I say, democracy is flawed, but you can't pick and choose what parts of democracy work for you. You can't say we're removing this part of democracy because it's a risk to you. Other countries have done that and they haven't ended up in great places. And I mean, you say I'm anti-lockdown. I'm pro-data more so. Because, I mean, people will say, oh, these are only conspiracy theorists. The Lancet said in the UK, government actions such as border closures, full lockdowns and a high rate of COVID-19 testing were not associated with statistically significant reductions in the number of critical cases or overall mortality. Official data from Germany's RKI agency said the spread of coronavirus receded autonomously before any interventions. In Israel, the evidence reveals that the corona disease declines even without a complete lockdown. It is recommendable to reverse the current policy and remove it. Sweden found similar. On and on it goes. And it's not just about now, Claire, because we don't have a roadmap. We have threats long into the future. Sam McConkie was on Matt Cooper's show a couple of weeks ago talking about restrictions for up to 5 years. Colm Henry of the HSE said restrictions will go on well into 2022. And he said on RTE that handshakes will never exist again in our lifetime.
Yeah, and yet they are going on in other countries. You're right. And it doesn't feel good. I mean, I'm not suggesting for any stretch that it does. I mean, I mentioned the only thing we've got to look forward to is April 5th, when we might be told that we can go a little further outside the 5 kilometres. So it is certainly getting